Now that we have compared G-code programming and shotmill programming, from today's lesson onwards we will focus on G-code programming, and above all, on the basic ISO aspects of G-code programming. Since this is a delicate and very important subject, let's not waste any more time. Paolo is with me, I am Paddy Day, and this is CNC, of course. From now on, we will only talk about programming in G-codes, and as we said in the preparatory lesson, we could also say ISO. But is this really the case? Paolo, what do you say? The answer is yes and no, meaning that Siemens G-code programming only partly corresponds to ISO programming. In fact, the ISO 6983, to be exact, describes all the main aspects of a program, explains the main functions, and also gives a complete list of G-functions. Reading the ISO, I can say that only partly the programming in G-codes corresponds to the pure ISO programming. In addition to the cycles, which are completely different, also some G-functions or some symbols such as comments and so on are different from what is mentioned in the ISO norm. But this is not a problem at all. Perhaps it is a good thing because the manufacturers of numerical controls, if they had remained tied to the ISO standard, would be stuck in 2009 with the last revision, and before that in 1983, when the ISO 6983 standard was published. Well, first of all, Paolo, I'd like you to explain why you want to do this. In any case, Siemens does everything in its power to make sure that if you want to program in the pure ISO version, all you have to do is set a machine datum, exactly 18,800. Setting bit 0 to 1 will enable the writing of programs in ISO programming, where, for example, for drilling you can use the cycles G81 to G83, for the releases, the functions G28, for the activation of the two-length corrector, the function G43, and so on. You are right, Paolo. That is the right question. Why do that? It doesn't make much sense to program a Siemens control in pure ISO. The reason is that you would lose a lot of possibilities and functions that Siemens has developed specifically. It is true that in such a case you could integrate a Siemens part into an ISO program using the G290 functions, but I would only leave this option for well-considered cases. So to summarise, there are three Siemens 840D programming modes. The first is the programming in G-code program guide, a programming that is partly ISO and partly extended by a whole series of functions developed by Siemens. Then we saw in the previous lesson shop mill, obviously for milling, and shop turn, its counterpart for turning. It is a very conversational and operationally oriented programming language. Finally, one last possibility we have seen in this lesson, namely pure ISO programming, which is only accessible with the configuration of the specific machine data. Here, the possibilities will be limited to ISO instructions to which Siemens functions can be integrated if necessary, using the G290 and G291 functions. In our course, we will deal with Siemens G-code programming and start by talking about the files that contain our program, starting with their management on board the machine. Those who have already followed the operating course will recall some information that I am now going to describe, but I believe it is essential to include in this course. The management of programs, or more generally, of files, takes place through the Program Manager menu. To access the program management, we have two ways. Through the main menu, then menu select, and then Program Manager. Or the short way, by pressing directly the Program Manager button in the operator panel. When the file management window opens, the following screen appears. With the horizontal soft keys, we select the unit we want to work on. The first of the units, and certainly always present, is the memory of the NC to which you can add a local drive, usually used for storing programs, and which may correspond to a network drive or a memory card. The third icon appears when a USB key is inserted into the machine and is used to operate on the files on the USB key. Before looking at the container, that is the folders and directories, let us try to understand the contents of these folders, starting with the files. The two files mainly used for programming are the main program files, which will have an extension .mpf, main program file, and the files relating to the subprograms, which will have the extension .spf, subprogram file. You're right, Paolo. Let's explain. A subprogram is basically a program that is called up by a main program. They are used in various cases. For example, to call up programs created using the CAM, or to repeat machining operations common to several pieces. To be clearer, the sequence is as follows. There is a main program, for example, workpiece1.mpf. Within this program, there is a call to an external subprogram, which in this case I have called slot16_100. When the control arrives at the subprogram call, it searches for the subprogram according to a specific procedure and executes it until it finds a subprogram end function, M17 or RET. At that point, the control returns to the main program and continues from the line following the subprogram call. For the sake of completeness, in addition to the .mpf programs and the .spf subprograms, we may find other files in our folders, which are shown in the chart on the right, and also in the additional information. We will see some of these files later on, but for the moment, it is enough for me to let you know that there are files with extensions besides MPF and SPF. Now that we have seen which files we can manage in our program manager, let's take a look at some of the rules concerning file names. At this time, we'll be talking mainly about MPF and SPF files. Let's start by saying that the file naming rules have evolved and will probably continue to evolve and become more flexible. Those who have seen the whole development of the 840D probably know something about this. However, as things stand, we can say that the NC accepts up to 24 characters for file names. They can be in upper or lower case, although I personally prefer to use capital letters. They may not contain arithmetic signs and may not contain spaces. For subprograms, the first two characters must be letters or possibly underscores. If you only want to use numbers, again speaking of subprograms, then you have to prefix them with a letter L, example L100. But please note that in this case, there must be no letters other than L. No other functions are required to open the file, except in cases where the program is sent by a serial link. And I refer you to the additional info for an exact explanation of the definition format of the program file when it is transferred via serial link. The end of file command is different. In fact, Siemens needs to have a function that defines the end of the program. To be precise, there are two M functions that define the end of the program, M30 and M2. Both have exactly the same function. They define the end of the program and restore all the conditions established with the reset status. The program is then ready to be run again from the beginning. As far as subprograms are concerned, the end is defined using the functions M17 or RET, as we said before. Once the execution reaches M17 or RET, it continues from the program from which the subprogram was called, as described above. The M17 or RET functions are similar but not identical, and the difference is exactly a different behavior compared to the G64 functions. What is it, Paolo? You are right, Paolo. We will have a chance to explain what the G64 function is. For now, we can say that G64 is the continuous operation mode, while G60 is its opposite and is the precise stop. The M17 function resets G64 if it was active by resetting G60, while RET keeps the G64 function always active. So, Paolo, I usually use RET because if I want to remove the G64 function, which is almost always active, I do it by programming a G60 or a similar function without the subprogram itself resetting the G60. I conclude by making a clarification on the end of program function. If you notice, I have used the words end of program and not end of file. In fact, the functions M30 or M2 define the end of the program, but it does not mean that you cannot put another part of the program after M30 or M2. Great, Paolo, you're paying attention. Paolo asked me, what do I put a program part under M30 or M2 for if the program ends anyway? He's not wrong, but in fact, during the course, we will see the use of labels to call program parts, and these program parts could also be placed under the M30 function. So when calling a label, the program will look for it under M30, execute it, and then return to the top. I would say that we have seen a lot of things today, and I must say that you have surprised me with your questions. Sometimes you amaze me. That's it for me and Paolo. We'll meet again at the next lesson, always here on CNC, of course.